thank you very much for staying. In the next few minutes, I'll be talking to you about ethics and some very interesting other things, but I see some people don't know who I am. Some of you recognize me, you know who I am. Okay, my name is Yannis Kalogeragis. I am a trainer for 38 years. I have 38, eh? I eat my words. That's Greekless, I eat my words. Okay, so my company is called JMK. JMK is just my initials, John Michael Kalogeragis. My father was called Michael. If my father's name was Fitzgerald, I could be an airport. Yes, I'm not an airport. I'm an anthropocentric company, and this is what is of interest of you for the next few minutes that you'll be listening to me. Thank you for putting up with my accent. Your ears are going to rejoice English with Peter later, and your eyes are going to feast on some beautiful slides because he's an artist. I'm just a trainer, so I'm trying very hard. Only my first slide is artistic. The rest are standard, Peter. Okay. In the next few minutes, I'll be talking to you about the divine simplicity of ethics. Because I believe ethics is simple. The dubious and the unethical is the complicated things we have in life. And I'll also be talking to you about the anthropocentric approach for creativity and innovation. You see, my thesis is that unless you have an anthropocentric approach, you cannot develop in your company creativity and innovation. It happens, and these are exceptions. So don't let the exceptions rule and govern our thinking. We have to work according to certain principles to get things the right way. Now, anthropocentric was not my word. I didn't think of it. It was Protagoras a few thousand years ago that he came up with this. And Protagoras said that the human being is the measure of all things. Everything is for the human being. Wikipedia thinks that anthropocentric is for the human being to be happy. No, because if I cut a tree in the Amazon river now, it affects my breathing tomorrow. If I do something for me to be happy against ethics, legal and all that, it will affect my living. So for the well-being of the human being, we have to be also ecological. So anthropocentric includes the ecological. We cannot destroy the planet and feel happy. So this is an update to Protagoras' thinking. At that time, we didn't have CO2 emissions and all that. I'm sure he was expecting us to develop his thinking. The human being. But the human being is responsible to continuously work and constantly become better and better and better and better. And there is no end to this. And better and useful, as Thodoris just said. Better and continuously to do that. You are not useful in a dead time and that's it. You are useful and always improve upon this continuously. This is an undisputed fact of all time. Every human being is made to continuously better itself. The business world of today is friendly, but it's also demanding. It's human, but it's also professional. Patient, but also fast. Classical, but also modern. Extreme, but also conservative. Creative, but also commercial. Emotional, but also logical. My God. These are two opposites. This is the definition of schizophrenia. So you, my friends, are all schizophrenics if you do business today. So you must, some of you have felt it. That's how crazy it is, because you have to balance between opposites. And the most important thing in you trying to balance this is that you have employees, you have collaborators, you have people, and there comes the biggest solution, or if you don't know how to handle them, the biggest problem. Stephen Covey said to me, John, the employee says, I will follow you if you inspire me with your vision, if you convince me with your ethics, if you treat me with respect, if you teach me new things, you do what you preach, you tell me the truth, you listen to me. And then he said to me that people believe in the leader first, then his vision, and then they work, then they produce. So that is the sequence. And I said to him, who said all this? You? He says, no. And he goes to his library and takes out the book. And in the cover, it was written, Pericles on Leadership. Pericles peri ηγεσίας. 3,500 years ago, it has all been said. And these are most useful today. We all need to become ethical leaders of character. We can inspire others and we can be inspired only by ethical leaders. This thing of the past that leaders were unethical is a thing of the past. It's gone. This is not our future. Humanity will not progress this way. So we have to think very carefully about this. And of course, people have free will. People choose their behavior daily. People choose. And you know what? We've been made by our Creator to have free choice. We have free choice. Nobody's forcing us to do anything, so we are free to choose. We're all free to choose. So let's influence people to choose for the better, for their families, for everyone, for the better. And of course, now with millennials, times have changed. Things are different. So millennials want from their managers, and they say, listen to my opinions tonight. Just listen. Never lie to me. Always tell me. This is research for millennials and Z. The previous was Pericles. Very similar, isn't it? Inspire me with your vision, because I'm looking for a role model. Can you become a role model for your employees? If not, you cannot inspire them. Walk the talk. Do as you preach. Tell me stuff, but don't hurt my ego. Just because I'm short, I'm fat, I'm big nose, don't hurt me. Don't tell me, boy, you didn't know this. Don't be ironic. Don't hurt me. I'm sensitive. I'm a human being. Challenge me, or I'll find someone else who will. So challenge the young people. They want this. By the way, you don't choose which one of these you like. All of them, eh? Okay, respect me. Respect me. And let's have some fun. It's not only work. Let's have some fun. And be flexible. I have many other parts in my life that I need to fit in. Maybe I do Pilates. Maybe I do, you know, volunteer work. By the way, this is something very top in the millennials' mind. So let them do it. You see, this is making some managers of today unease. But this is it. Times are changing. So ethical leaders. Ethical leaders is much more than legalities. We have some lawyers in the audience. Okay, so, okay, there is a huge... the volumes and volumes of laws. If you go to their office, you'll see all the books. Huge. Ethics is much bigger than that, and it's not written necessarily. So I wanted you to see in perspective that there are legal stuff. It's included, but ethics is much bigger. And of course, unethical is huge, but we're not talking about that. Make sure everything is done ethically. Within reason, of course. What? What reason? What is this? He implies we have to make money and don't overdo it, don't overspend, don't do this, don't do that. That's not ethics. I teach systemics at the University of Piraeus, and this is the professor, Nikita Zasimakopoulos, that he has said something that I keep very dear to my heart. He's the president of the Hellenic Society of Systemic Studies. He has said that, John, he said to me, ethics reduces complexity. Things become complex in companies because people are lying, people are unethical, people see for their own good, not for the team, not for the company. And they do things that they are not correct. So they make things so complicated, and it's not easy to sort them out. I'm talking to you about the divine simplicity of ethics, because I think it's really very simple. Everyone in this room knows that the financial crisis happened because there was an ethics crisis first. This is what caused the financial crisis. There is an excellent book by the Archbishop of Canterbury and by the editor of economics editor of Guardian, talking about the crisis, which is really ethical. So they describe in there what I just said. We need a better world. We need to have economic studies, and this is ethics. Many years ago, I was following a page, it still exists, ethicscrisis.com. Forgive me, Father, for I have mismanaged. Not I have sinned, I have mismanaged. And in there, I made a record of some of the things that people wrote anonymously. So here are some of the things that I copied. These are real people opening up their hearts. I lied to get new businesses. Vento sent me a vacation and I accepted it. I stole and I blamed someone else. I lied to my boss to protect my friend. Now you say maybe he was a good friend. No, that's teaching his friend wrong. We totally fabricated our numbers. I set up my boss so I could have his job. We paid the rival's employee for information. We gave mortgages to people that we knew they couldn't pay. Why you did that? You think that's good practice, good business? And you are wondering why we had a financial crisis? People in my company take home lots of office supplies. I gave a friend an advantage in a bidding process. Journalism students were cheating on ethics exam. They be caught. I made extra money on my business travel on false expenses. I have people, when I was traveling, say, excuse me, would you use that receipt? You know, I'm just going to throw it. No, can I have it? So obviously he's collecting it to ask at the end an expense report and ask his company for expenses he didn't do. Well, let me tell you, I once took a marker from the company at home to write. I wanted to note something on a big box. And we did that, and then I left the marker at home. And I felt unease. And from the very little I knew at the time on psychology, I took the decision to take the marker back. Nobody told me, well done, bravo. But I promise you, I slept very, that's not me, but I slept very well at night because I was happy I did that. To me, it's as simple as I just said. It is really simple to start businesses on the right foot. And then we need to educate our youngsters. We need to teach them that there is right and wrong. We need to tell them it is wrong to cheat on an ethics exam. How important ethics this is, and everybody is trying to copy him. It is absolutely wrong, and I'm so glad that MindSpark keeps all these very high on his priority. That's why you see me, Theodoris, and all these people coming, because it is a priority for the future. I also maintain that ethics is a one-way street. There is no doubt about it, and it's a simple street. It is unethical, which is complicated. And as you can see, this is our plan. And why you make it so complicated? So nobody asks questions and you get your own thing. Okay, it looks, it's a cartoon, but it depicts a real story of people trying to say things complicated. They say, did you understand? You're afraid to say no. She says, okay, let's go with it. Why things are, people make things so complicated? Steve said that simple is harder than complex. You have to work very, very hard to get your thinking clean and make it simple. Every time I listen to Peter, I see this simple and powerful. And this is it, isn't it? It's not as easy as it looks. Sometimes you look and say, it's so damn simple. Well, let me tell you, it's not. There is a lot of effort, a lot of mathematics going behind. They use the golden ratio to make this is produced out of precision circles. Pepsi used the golden ratio for their logo. It's 1.618. So it looks simple, but there is a lot of work behind and before you can see something and you judge it as simple. And Aristotle has said the very amazing and simple things that with our daily actions, we physically modify our brain to become better. You see, these are neuroconnectors. Let's say you see your little son goes to fire, puts the hand in the fire. Oh, it hurts. Now he has a connection that says, if I put hand on fire, I get pain. Well, there you have it. What do you practice at work? Because you teach your brain to behave. So whatever you practice, Aristotle said, you'll become expert. Because we are what we repeatedly do. Excellence is not an act. It's a habit. So we have to do that continuously. So what do you do every day? If you practice nagging and swearing, you'll be expert at nagging, expert at swearing. What do you practice? Because you'll become expert at it. So you want to be better person? You want to be useful person? Start practicing it. And this is it in Cappella Sistina. Aristotle insisted that the pursuit of ethics is practical rather theoretical or speculative. The problem is that Plato talk about the divine. Aristotle talk about here and now. This is the difference why Plato points upwards. I'm actually, Michael, maybe on the next caricature, you can make me pointing down because I talk about the earth. I'm not so much, but because this talk about the divine, we leave it. So he said that you have to have a balance. This icon in Cappella Sistina is telling us about the balance in life. Of course, you have to act, but you have to realize where it all comes from. And those of you who attended TEDx Alexandroupolis, I had the title, Go Brand Yourself. You know, go brand yourself from go yourself. And I said, I'll be very happy, but I'm going to add another word at the bottom. Go brand yourself ethically. So my TEDx talk is ethically. Go brand yourself ethically. And in Alexandroupolis, I said a couple of years ago that ethics, not big coins, ethics is the currency of the future. Yet, we see some people that they do damage. Who raised them? Who was their father, their mother? Who was their manager? I'd like to see their managers, their teachers, their tutors. And of course, say to them, shame on you, who didn't teach them the right stuff. So, little young boys and girls, they do damage to companies, and then they ask for ransom to send the bitcoins to Cayman Islands and all this. Wow! And of course, the more of these things come, the more technology raises and finds all this and stops them and blocks them and firewalls and all that. Do you know that someone, you are on metro or you are in a bus, and someone can come and just near, not touch, near, on your wallet and take 20 euros, 20, 20, 20, 20, because contactless, right? Well, okay, technology comes. Now, here is yesterday I was training Brinks, and they gave me a card, says, put this on your wallet, and it will stop the bad people. Now, I'm sure the bad people will find some other things because they're bad. What? Who was their tutor? Because this was an amazing story in Silicon Valley. She made millions instant, a new startup. Theranos was the product, then the name of the company. So what she did was she promised the world that from a small drop of blood, you can have all the blood tests and you don't need to take bottles and bottles of blood. I believe one day this will be true. But it was too early. Technology could not do all that promised. It did quite a lot on that small box, but not as promised. And she actually bullshitted her way into lying to get millions in stock exchange and got some amazing investors who put a lot of money, these are her investors, who put a lot of money in the hoping to make more money. And then the book came out and explained to us that she was a lie. And her chief engineer, this guy, was so embarrassed working for an unethical boss, he committed suicide. And this is the box, and I honestly believe one day it will be a reality. But she had no feelings for the world, for the people working for them. I believe one day it will be available to masses, but will it be for everybody or only for the rich ones? Today, nanorobots exist, and they can go into your bloodstream and they can correct certain diseases. They're on experimental stage. Soon they'll be available to the society. But is society helping the human beings? Are these scientists basing everything they do on ethics? Were they used to do ethical things or steal things, markers, and not return them? Does AI really assist humanity for a better living? And you know, AI is not as expert as you would like to think. Damn it, Facebook deleted my picture again because you have to take your twins out of the way. Facebook thinks it's another thing. Does technology really serve humanity or is the opposite true? From the very beginning of time, humanity evolves continuously. Civilizations flourish due to the creativity and innovation of people. Civilizations are also destroyed due to human greed and ego. So choose. What future do you want? Choose. Do we need more wars? Because after a war, there is buildings, there is amazing technology goes fast. Do we need more wars in order to develop? Or do we have to think, what is the baseline? Or do we need to teach and empower and educate everybody and our children? I teach creativity. It can be taught. If you are wondering, and those who like books, De Bono. Get the De Bono books. In Greek, it's Konstantinos Magnisalis. Some books exist. They teach you creativity. Or Ioannis Paraskevopoulos, the Φιλακπαιδευτική Εταιρεία. There are books that teach you creativity. And I have been taught by Magnisalis, and I teach, I call it CQ, Creative Quotient. Creativity can be taught. There are books you can buy on Amazon about Creativity Quotient, Magnisalis' book, The Six Hats of De Bono. I teach the six hats of how to be creative. What does that mean? Anybody can be creative. Picasso said, every children is born creative, and then they go to school and they take creativity out. He has to comply. He has to be like a soldier. We have to let people expand their horizons. Do you know how it's called? The School of Nature in Thessaloniki, Σχολείο της Φύσης. They started changing all this. Excellent work. You see, people need first to be empowered anthropocentrically, which includes all the ethics and all this that I just said. So first you empower, and then you give them the techniques. You give them the techniques, and they don't have a good basis. Their products are false. Therefore, making rich their own pockets. When Sophia came last year, Megara Moustakis,
do you understand the concept of ethics?
And she ironically says,
I like it.
I understand. Of course. With Wi-Fi connected, with all the
books. Would you do something unethical if you were programmed to think that it is ethical by some dubious and clever guy lying to you? Would you do something unethical?
I'm still learning a lot about ethics and morality. Okay. I'm trying to make the best decisions that I can and really study hard.
She talked like a politician, but she's a genius little thing, creation. So, after 20 minutes of interview, I came around to the same thing. I wasn't going to give up. And the opportunity came when she said to me, you can ask complicated questions. Because she went on my LinkedIn and saw who I am. And my PhD is on robotics. And says, don't be afraid to ask me complicated questions. So, okay, I said, I was expecting, hoping for that.
If you ask complicated questions, I can handle them.
I can handle them. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So if someone programs you to think that bad is good, then you will do bad, thinking it's good. Correct?
I think I have a nice voice. But this thing, I have to be programmed ahead of time. I guess it's just like a human that needs to rehearse in a way.
You see, what she just said is that I need to be programmed, I need to practice to become good. This is, in our human terms, education. This is your manager, this is your father, these are your friends. What do they teach you? Are they toxic? Do they take you into dark areas and thoughts? Or do they teach you the right thing? Your teachers, your fathers, your mother. So this is it. Unless we are programmed, taught, or programmed, upbringing, call whatever you want in program. Well, and a robot has to tell us this. Amazing. And then I said, thank you, Sophia, for talking.
For three years, amazing, Sophia. Thank you for talking to us.
Oh, no, no, no.
I'm going to
turn
next month.
I'm a lady. Don't make me look older. I'm going to be three next month. Amazing. The conversation was amazing. Anyway, I had some internal auditors. Is there any internal auditor in here in the audience? Internal auditor said to me, it will be very difficult to automate and put AI in us because we do a lot of work. Well, here comes Sarah.
Hello, I'm Sarah. I've been working in the internal audit department for 9 months now.
Any accountant and turn them into an
he
internal audit.
He will test and guide you in the daily work of the internal auditor.
Has all legislation in the background.
He thinks that internal audit is not independent. He also thinks internal
audit
is
not
objective.
Right now is an app.
How should I demonstrate the objectivity of the internal auditors when performing their work?
Sophia has another version, a little cartoon thing called Einstein that connected to the Wi-Fi, like Siri and all this. Siri, stay. and your kid can ask questions in any language, can get an answer in any language. So soon we're going to have it in our homes. The best teacher you could ever wish. But we have to build in ethics, of course. As I said to you earlier, my PhD is in robotics. I have hundreds of papers in robotics. I have many awards in robotics. This is Isaac Asimov, a fiction writer. And on the right, you see Joseph Engelberger, the father of industrial robotics. Now, Isaac Asimov said something, and because it is science fiction, all his books, I thought it was just a science fiction thing. And then Joseph said to me, Engelberger said to me, John, we worked together in many projects that Joseph Engelberger and me, when I had the black hair, we worked together in many for hospitals. We worked in far to today. There is Da Vinci. I didn't work on Da Vinci. I work on other robotics. And Joseph Engelberger said to me, the three laws of robotics, John, don't you ever let them go. Keep them in the back of your mind. I said, come on, it's a joke. He says, no. And I see his sayings being so important now that we talk about ethics in technology. So let me tell you what are these three basic laws. A robot may not injure a human being or through inaction allow a human being to come to harm. A robot must obey the orders given by human beings except where such orders conflict with the first law. And a robot must protect its own existence as long as such protection does not conflict with the first or second law. This guy, years ago, predicted that unless we put some ethic ground, technology is not going to develop for the benefit of society. But listening to Petros earlier, I'm convinced we know and we have what it takes. We can have a better world. All what it takes is to work together with IT people and man and machine always work hand in hand ethically for the benefit of society. And you've heard me in the past, or those of you who've heard me talking, I always say managing change, just these two words are ridiculous. It's wrong. You cannot manage change. It's for small projects, this. It's leading change is the correct word. Leading. You cannot apply management principles in change. You have to inspire people. You have to empower them. So these are the right books. And if you have any books on managing, throw them out of the window. Burn them. These are the right books to read. I was in a conference once, and Ken Blanchard said, Pythagoreans, every night before they sleep, they used to say, anybody knows what Pythagoreans used to say every night before they sleep? Every time I go to a conference in the United States and I listen to them talking about ancient Greeks, I'm embarrassed because I don't understand the English. They say, Kylikelos ou Kyliavs. I said, that's a Greek now, but I don't know who he is. They pronounce Odysseus Ulysses. You know, P, Pi, Mi, Mnu. And I say, it's another language. Okay, Peter, you laugh, but the phonetic thing is difficult for us. So every time I listen to all this, I'm amazed. But I'm also a lot more amazed and impressed when I hear them talking in Greek and saying things that I have no idea. Pythagoreans, every night before they sleep, they used to say, Piparevin, tiderexa, timideon, uketelesti. What law have I overcome? What did I do wrong? What should I have done? What should I have done, but I didn't do? Did I do anything wrong today? Pythagoreans had a self-diagnostic check and controlled themselves to become better and useful all the time to society, to family. You see, all of this is under the word of excellence, but excellence cannot be ordered. You cannot order someone to be excellent. Excellence can only be inspired. The history books is full of people who made a difference in this world because they had passion, they had love for what they did, and they didn't have common religion, they didn't have the same education, they didn't go to the same, they didn't come from the same country. So what's the big secret? They had one thing in common, vision based on deep spirituality. And spirituality is in turn based on ethics. Only such people can change the world. I hope you can be this type of a person to make the difference, not only in your team, in your house, in your family, but in your company and in the society. Sometimes when I train youngsters, I say to them, someone believed in you because someone hired you. Someone loves you. You have a child together. And some even paid for your studies. Eh? I know some of you studied abroad. So I know who paid for your studies, your family. Someone said to me, I worked and paid for my studies. Okay, if you work, it's your effort. Otherwise, it's your family. So here I come and I say to you, and now, that your manager or the EU put the bar higher, are you going to prove them right? Are you going to prove their trust, their decision to hire you, their decision to marry you, their decision to have a child with you, their decision to pay for your, the decision for you to work hard? Are you going to give credit to this effort? And to the young ones, I always let them see this picture and I keep silent. And I let them soak it in. Because this guy must give his everything because his father doesn't even wear shoes so that his son has shoes. So when someone puts trust into you and hires you and employs you, when someone takes you for a project in their company, when someone marries you, you have to honor this. When someone puts their money, their time, their effort, you have to honor this. I'm sorry if I made some of you uncomfortable. I had to make you uncomfortable so that you could become better. Who said that? Life. And from now on, of course, you can say I've heard it on Mindspark. In closing, I want to say that ethical, ecological, sustainable, because this is the anthropocentric training, is up to every one of us. So let's promote it. We have life, we have time. And this is wise Snoopy, that when Charlie Brown said to him, what's the point, Snoopy? We're all gonna die. Wise Snoopy replied, true, but all the other days we're not gonna die, so let's work. Let's go to work. As I said in the beginning, this is an undisputed fact. We are made by our Creator to constantly become better and better and better. You see, the bees, they do the same thing for billions of years. The dolphins, very clever creatures. The octopus, very clever, but they don't evolve. They don't produce civilizations. Only we are human beings. It's constructed by the Creator. That's our mind created to become better. So my proposal, if you want something practical, is to do anthropocentric leadership and coaching and mentoring. I didn't touch on mentoring, but it's how to guide someone for his career. Coaching is to make him see inside that he's got the power and he can find the solution. Mentoring is to develop his career. Anyway, by the way, I wanted to say that mentor for the our friends in Canada to feel very proud, is the name of a guy in Ithaca that he was responsible to coach Telemachus when Ulysses, Odysseus, went to the Trojan War. And he was, of course, had the wisdom of Athena. Anyway, so Anthropocene performance and development review. The problem is that in every company, people don't want to be assessed. They don't want to be assessed because they say, why am I not doing my job right? So you have to say to them that I'm going to develop you through this assessment. So it's performance and development review. It's not just performance review. Performance and development, and it has to be done anthropocentrically. And finally, we have to develop all the cues, EQ, SQ, CQ, and ethical cue, ethical quotient. Kazantzakis said it in Spiritual Exercises, in his book, you have to love responsibility and say that it's my duty and my duty alone to save the earth. And if the earth is not saved, I alone am to blame. Can we all take this responsibility back into our families, our projects, our everyday work, and teach it to our children to be responsible, ethical, and develop this way? Because as the beginning of the Mindspark today, Petros reminded us, technology will always evolve. Technology will be at the aid of the humanity. Technology will be there. So I want to close by saying that systems make things possible. It's people that always make things happen. Thank you very much for listening to me.